Happy New Year, everyone. You may be wondering why I would say to you on today, August 12th, 2015, Happy New Year. That's because today, from my location in Sedona, it is the beginning of the famous and classical ancient Egyptian New Year, called the Heliacal Rising of Sirius, the Peret Spedet, or the Parutwa Sopedu. This happens once a year, as all New Years do happen, when the star Sirius resurrects from the dead, we say. It appears as the first star of dawn. So right when the sun rises, there's a star, while it's still a bit dark out, that shines. And this star is Sirius, or Sopedu, which you see here. Sopedu, which is Sirius. Here is the glyph for Sirius, showing here its glyphic determinatives and letters. This glyph here represents a black hole. Yes, this represents mass or matter, and this represents a star. So this is the star Sirius shown in our glyphs, and here we have an image of a mummiform being. This is an initiate who has become purified or mummified, incorruptible, absorbing star energy, star chi, into his higher brain centers. Before his, Bob Bird called his soul, his divine spark or mortal spark, showing that we Africans of the Nile Valley have always turned to the stars to absorb their rays, their energies. We come from the stars, and each star contains information. It contains powers, and it contains talents. And this was the basis of astrology, where that which is above connects to that which is below and influences you. It affects your mind. This is showing how the stars influence the mind, and how the soul, or the Ba, witnesses how our charts influence us once we're under initiation. And here we have a symbol of one of our what's called veves or bango. Some know them as sigils or sacred yantras for the star Sirius. This comes from the Dogon tradition. This is the Dogon voodoo symbol for invoking the star Sirius. And here we have the Great Pyramid of Giza, where its southern shaft is aligned to Sirius, showing that we had worshipped this star for millennia in the Nile Valley. So today, August 12, 2015, I'm in Sedona, Arizona, at the latitude of 34 north of the equator. So every August 12th, at my latitude, any city along this latitude, 34 north of the equator, will have Sopedu Sirius as their heliacal rising star, because the heliacal rising phenomena, which we'll discuss in detail in a moment, is very latitude sensitive. So if you are in Florida, it will be a different day. If you're in New York, a different day still. If you're in Rio, a different day altogether. Any latitude that can see the star would have that visible phenomena occur at different dates of the year, but it will always be the same calendar date at that latitude for about 100 years or so, about a century. So in your lifetime, if you are in Florida, if you are in New York, if you are in Anchorage, Alaska, whatever the date where this star appears at dawn, heliacally, happens in your calendar will be the same calendar date every year for about a century and change. So I want to take a few moments to explain to you what a heliacal rising star is from first a bit of a technical point of view. It's important to understand the astrophysics a bit, to know how we took the physics and morphed it into a metaphysic, into a philosophy. So basically, you have here a picture of yourself going out at night, and you see a star. Let's call it Sirius. Let's call it Sopedu. So you go out one night, several nights, several weeks of a night, several months, and you see Sopedu, around a certain time of the year. Then you notice that around sunset here, when the sun's below the horizon setting, there is a star right on its tail. So here we have just a star at night, but then something happens where the star appears to be right behind sunset. Okay, this is called a chronicle setting. That's the technical term, but it means at sunset, a star follows right behind the sun. We would say in Kemet that this star is in the back of the boat of Ra and is falling into the sun. You see, it's almost kind of falling into the sun towards being burned in the fires of purification. It's kind of a baptism by fire. And each night, this star will set with the sun a little closer, a little closer, a little closer, becomes so close that it becomes what we call combust, or invisible. The sun will blot it out. When this star is blotted out by the sun, by being so close to it, it disappears in the night sky. So we would erase this little white star, and all of a sudden, Sirius, that you saw for weeks at a certain time of the year, simply is not in the night sky. It has vanished. We say it has died. Then, after several weeks of not seeing it, not seeing it, not seeing it, at dawn, right before sunrise, it returns. It reappears. But now in the front of Ra, we say in the front of his boat. Okay? So here he was more in the back of the boat, falling into the sun, about to die into the fires of purification. Then he disappeared for several weeks. Then the next time you see the star, it's in the front of the boat. It flipped to the front and has returned. So we see here a rhythm of death, resurrection. Death, resurrection. The star falls into the sun and dies. You can't see it for weeks. Then it returns in the morning, renewed, refreshed, or resurrection. So this here is called the resurrection star. The star has resurrected. Here it's dying. It dies when it's in the back of the sunset boat. It is heliacal rising when it returns in the front of the sunrise boat. This is very important, these astrophysics. Because there's a misconception that any star that rises right before the sun is a heliacal rising star. This is not true. To be a heliacal rising star versus what's called a morning rising star, it has to go through this process of falling into the sun, dying and disappearing, and then returning at dawn. It must have this dying, disappearing, and returning pattern, and not simply appearing at sunrise. Okay? When a star goes through this phasing of dying, being burnt in the fires of purification, and returning at dawn, we call that the resurrection star, or an ancestor star. And during the time the star was gone, it was in the lake of fire of baptism, of purification, and with the ancestors. When it returns at dawn, it's renewed, reborn like an ancestor from the dead, reincarnating with a new directive, new message, and a new mission. This is very important. Okay, now, so Sopedu is a star, back to here, this star Sopedu, that deals with kings mostly. It is a royal star and deals with kingly preferment, with status, with social power. It deals with wealth and honor. And it is known as the burning star. This star is famous for creating fires. Here in Arizona, around this time of the year, when Sopedu resurrects, we have a lot of forest fires in the desert. Or desert fires, I should say, yes. Also, Sapedu was said to be the star of the drop, the teardrop. And it was at the time of the rising of the Nile that we noticed Sirius was also resurrecting here. When this happened, we noticed that there were more fires in Kemet, and that the flood would rise, the Nile would flood. And it so happens here in Sedona, which is very similar to Egyptian landscape. Sedona is like an oasis, but it's desert area. It's very self-similar to ancient Kemet, that during the time of the heliacal rising of Sirius, we have what's called monsoon season, although we're a desert. That's why Sedona is so very, very green. So again, we've had these rainstorms, we've had fires, the burning scorcher of Sirius, and the rising of the waters. So Sirius is still doing its thing. So this morning, Sopedu rose with Khonsu. I performed a royal ceremony to the god Khonsu Sopedu, and when the men and my person looked east, we could see the crescent of Khonsu, the moon. It was a very beautiful visual as the sun was rising, and it was a bit cloudy today, so we couldn't see the star, but we knew where it was by our geometry. And just the beauty of the dawning sky and the filling of light and the moon still hanging on through the sunrise. It was a very moving and touching visual experience. And I invoked the spirits and the voodoo rituals of the sky gods in these stars. And there were also planets present this morning. So that was Khonsu, the moon. We also had Ra was very close to Venus or Venus. Mars or Herdesher was also in the sky, as were Bes, Uranus, and Neptune, Nu. But those last two are invisible to the human eye, but I knew where they were from my astronomy calculations. So this image here shows the function of astrology is to absorb starry energies into your higher brain centers to wake them up, to register and download the information in those stars. The stars are like computer programs in the sky. They contain data information. Whether you're a scientist and you look at a star, you get data from it. Spectral analysis, gas analysis, it contains data. But it also contains subtle data, psychic data, spiritual data. So we're able to download the information. So the star Sopedu downloads information of purification for a cause. This star deals with the fact that in order for you to make a cause come to birth, you have to sacrifice something. That cause will burn you in some way. It's going to have to take something from you. It teaches you there is no free lunch in the universe. So if you're going to commit to a mission or a cause, that could be a revolutionary cause, it could be a cause for philosophy, it could be a spiritual cause, it could be for a cause for your project or for your family. Whatever you're committing to, it's going to demand and exact a price from you, and the price will burn. So, this star reminds you that in order for you to survive this sacrifice you must now undertake, this burning, that you have to awaken your chakras. Sopedu deals a lot with the chakra system, what we call the Arau, or the Aratu, or the Arit, the seven chakras. There were more chakras, but seven major ones. A scale of notes, of chakras. So, in order for you to be able to withstand the demands of your cause and to come out shiny and bright, no matter what it demands of you, you need to awaken your chakras because the boat of Sopedu, this star had a deity, and the deity sailed across the watery cosmic Nile in a boat. But the boat had 50 oarsmen. 50, 50. That's an important number. Because 50 is the number of sounds in the classical chakra system. There are more sounds and more chakras than 50, but the primary fundamental ones are the 50 heka of the chakras. So Sopedu reminds you that you have within you a resource of powers. Besides your physical powers and hitting the pavement and hard work, you have metaphysical powers and spiritual forces to make things happen. The word Sopedu means the provider. When you open your chakras, magically, the universe provides for you. Okay, then I divined what is the mission for this new year? What does the star Sopedu bring as a message and a gift to us? So through the oracle, the great high oracle of Ra, I was able to get the download that we must all input into our biocomputers, into our spiritual systems, of what we must now focus on. And the answer was this god here named Min. I believe we skipped an image here. Let's see. Yes, here we are. Okay. The god Min. This is the god that comes for the new year. This is the god of male phallic sexuality, the butch side of men. So I asked the oracle, who comes in the boat of Sopedu? And Min said, I come in the boat of Sopedu. And note, this beautiful black brother has a beautiful erect penis, yet there are no testicles shown. Because the testes contain the sperm, the seed. And by showing him without testicles, it refers to the fact that he has absorbed his sperm, his seed energy, called in the Taoist system the jing. Yes, we call it sa in Egyptian, which means magical protection or nectar. He has absorbed his testicle power into his being, meaning he's had what's called ejaculations. He had what's called an internal orgasm, where he had a full orgasm without ejaculation. So, Min came for the gay men around the world and said, this year is a year where you have to grow up sexually. Sure, having hot man sex is fun, it's thrilling, it's exciting. Do continue, be safe, be wise, but enjoy that part of life. It is a gift of life. But Min said there's another side of gay men's sexuality, which is a more sublime level of sex. It's sex where you don't lose your seed. That's why he has no testes again. It's sex where you learn to, at the moment of orgasm, instead of shooting forth your bow and arrow, you shoot it within, up your spine, up the chakras to the crown center. You see, he's got a very tall crown on his head here. These golden plumes here represent the two brain lobes elevated to a high level of consciousness, raised up very, very high, forming this kind of halo of feathers, where the halos that you see in many Western art forms, paintings, came from this. You see? Where you use your sexual energy. The word testicles has the word testa, which means turtle or tortoise, as well as to witness, like testimony or testament. Yes? So your testes, when you absorb their energy, give you the power of witness consciousness or higher consciousness, where you're more of an observer, the divine observer. It expands what the mind can see, the testament, the witnessing. You see? So we're talking about sexual alchemy or tantra. So this year, enjoy your hot gay male sex on the physical plane, but let's try to broaden and expand our experience of our gay sexuality and to begin to look into the sublime, non-ejaculatory kind of sex, where you take that energy and you do deep breathing and you do certain breath locks, and then you hold that energy in and you loop it inside of your system. This will make you a genius. You'll be so packed full of energy. This god Min is the god of lightning, lightning and thunder. So when you control your testicle energy and you circulate it back within the system without losing sperm, notice here he has another, this flail, this arm is upraised. It's the same angle basically as this angle of his penis. So he's taken his penis energy and lifted it with his hand, meaning he's handled it in a higher fashion. This is a flail that whips you. It whips the wheat from the chaff, meaning discipline. Learning to not just have the physical side of sex. So now we have to learn this year physical sex and metaphysical sex, what's called Jing Yoga in Taoism, or Tantra. And that means circulating energy within yourself, having an internal explosion. Don't confuse orgasm with ejaculation. They are separate biological phenomena and moments of the sex act. This is, you can look up any, go on Google and find out difference between orgasm and ejaculation. They are two different phenomena in the sexual act. You can separate them. You can have an orgasm without having ejaculation. And that's what he's talking about. So this image here shows two gay men embracing each other in the eye and both aroused at the sight of each other, raising up their energy. This blue stand means divine order, or your astrology chart perfected. So they're using sexual energy to lift their sexual power up, to nourish the higher brain centers through an act of sexual discipline well handled. And here we have these two sashes, which represent cloth. Here's in a mummy form, which is also cloth. And cloth is always code for the subtle body, the spirit body that clothes the physical body. And then we have another image here showing Min again, but this time over his shrine here we see some plants. Plants represent the plant kingdom, which is the part of you that responds to sunlight or starlight, what's called your shahut or your aura or your subtle meridian chakra bodies. And here we see the central chakra spine channels. Yes, here's the chakra spine. Here we have the pineal pituitary glands, the central column, the space between the brain, and these two leaves going left and right are the corpus callosum, and these two kind of teardrop shapes represent the two channels of the meridians, the left and right Idapingala channels. Note they also slightly resemble testes. They have a testicular shape, so we have a phallus here shooting upward. We could say it's ejaculating upward. And the testes power is packed, meaning you have great big cojones. But they're all pointing up. Note the very upward feeling of all the shapes here. And they're pointing up inside of his whip, meaning he has taken his power. And remember I said this angle is the penis elevated, the same angle here, just tilted. He's taken a handle on elevating this energy. This last image shows again a similar form of a mummified man, Min, with a hawk body behind him, meaning a champion and master who is aroused, and we have an upraised snake with arms and legs who's also aroused. So we've two male forces meeting each other. Very gay. And this hawk means that he has mastered his sexual energy in a very calm state, wearing the white crown of the positive gay DNA, and in that state, his kundalini rises up his spine in a sexual energy and hails him. So this is the key to Min, raising up the cobra of kundalini, which is seen here with two legs and a large African phallus. So that is the goal for this year. So I'm going to start producing availability for workshops on this science of the Kemetic version of Tantra, what we call Sa, or sexual nectar. And I'll be opening classes to teach this year, so you can have, throughout the year, the joy of male sex, man-on-man sex, but two kinds, one physical and one spiritual. You get two for one. This is a good thing. So, stay tuned for our workshops. Dwa Wend Huy Tuap.